Hey everyone, Butley here. I'm here with Patch again. How you doing today, Patch?
I'm doing pretty good.
Good.
I don't know why I spoke like that. Just, yeah.
Jolly good day to you, sir.
Meriden.
Yeah, so I this is silly. This is just my preference. I tend to sort my units in terms of basically tankiness to squishiness. And for a while I was just leaving all the low level people at the back so they didn't get mixed up with the actual party members that we were actively using. But here I just decided, no, we're going to start leveling people up and integrating them into the team, and if I'm going to organize them, yeah. Excuse me, time to set up how I usually set up. The cool thing is, like, just even having the option to do this, I know it seems silly and obvious that this should be a feature, but yeah, it's cool that you even can, you know. I can sort it manually, I can sort it by level, I can sort it by class, name, I can do all sorts of sorting. I just do it manually though. And we've finished training, we're going to go on with the story.
There's a story to this game?
Had a few options, had a bit of a side quest, but we're going to ignore that for the moment and go on towards where the Duke told us to go.
And are we going to meet an old friend this time?
I always say that, and yes is the answer. From now on, every mission, we're just meeting old friends. Not
excellent.
Actually fighting.
That's what I like to hear.
We just invite 10 people to a tea party, and that's it. This is a really quick episode, guys. We meet Balbatos, you know, headless Balbatos, and have a tea party.
Can't even remember who that is anymore.
He's one of the three emperor guys. And when
Duke Brownie
won, he executed him. He's the one with the guillotine. On the guillotine. I think that's what the head chopping machine is.
That's what a guillotine is, yes.
Yep. What am I thinking about here? Oh, right. So I know... This is like a... I know a mission that's coming and I am sort of prepping for it, and I just can't remember if it... Like, everyone, it's like, is it this one? Is it this one? Is it this one? And so the team's about that. But I'm also trying to... I've got, like, plans for certain characters that I want to get up and running, so I'm trying to, like... I think I put... is that Beastmaster Little John? Yeah, Little John. So I'm trying to get him in the team as well, just so he can get some levels. This is how I typically level people up. Once your main team is sort of organized and you've got enough traits that even being equal level with your enemies, you're a competitive fighter.
Pious woman, my favorite old friend.
What do you mean, Divold, right? Remember him. What's going on down there? We distracted him long enough for that guy to attack him.
He's gonna leave after that, he's offended.
Yep.
So these are, clearly this is the,
this is the dude. The dude.
You know who that guy was? From way back? The necromancer. This is his doing.
Nebeth?
Yep. You know how I know that it's his doing? It's because everyone's purple and acting like a zombie, including Gilbert.
Gildas.
Whoever that was. Gildas.
Gilbert's
I'm getting
team.
Confused with Gilbert, yeah. Wait, there's a dead person there!
Get him.
Save them! I mean, not the undead, I mean the actual dead.
What?
Oh! Are they going to come back to life?
Yes.
Okay. This is starting to make sense. I'm beginning to piece together what this round's going to be about.
So this is an easy mission until everything starts reviving.
No, see, I remember when you fought the necromancer the first time, he had all those, or his apprentice, she had all those undead, and you had to use your clerics to kill them.
Right. And so this is my thing. I know that we're fighting undead, and when I was saying I was trying to pick a team... The problem is you can't use your clerics to just use heal spells to kill them because they won't have the mana to sustain the damage that you need. So you sort of still need to take a fighting team. But then if your clerics, because they're the only ones who can learn the exorcism to destroy them, if they're doing that, they're not using mana to heal. So then you need an appropriate amount of healing to sustain your frontline.
Yeah. But if you've got knights, then you're not bringing a significant amount of damage.
You got it. So this is why it's a bit awkward. And I'm also trying not to overuse the rune fences because and archers because they're way powerful. So that's why I like having this guy, Gilbert, because he's like an archer cleric Vartan thing, and he was a rune fencer, I believe. So he sort of gives you that archery and that healing without, but he's not trading off. Like, he still gives plenty of damage and he still gives appropriate healing. Whereas knights...
He can do anything.
Well, knights give you sort of healing, but they take away a lot of your damage. At least as we get going, they'll take away a lot of the damage. What was I looking at there? I'm not entirely sure.
I don't know either.
I
don't know why you're asking me these questions.
You'll note there, the answer. As I went to that screen, there's like a weather. Like, it's raining, obviously. But that's not just for effect. Weather actually affects, like...
Oh, yeah, I
weather affects, like, your ranged abilities and your line of sight sometimes, and it might even be damage or accuracy of arrows and stuff like that, so it's kind of cool.
Rip, ghost.
So you can see there, it went down. It's doing like we do when my guys go down. Maybe that's the secret. Our team's all undead, so when we get knocked down, we go down for 3 turns.
No, you have to use the blessing stones.
Yeah, that's true.
Yours is much more expensive.
Yeah.
These are expendable.
Yeah, blessing stones are expensive. I kid you not. Like, if you're not economical about not wasting them early in the combat when you don't have many units, like, because early on when you're only taking like 6 or 7 people to a battle, if someone goes down, it's a big deal. But if you're not economical about using them, it cripples you by this point in the game, because money's not free-flowing. Like, we've never really struggled for money, and you might look at me and go, oh, well, you did all that crafting stuff and wasted it all. Well, yeah, but I haven't actually really done that much crafting. I think half the reason if there's any battles I have trouble with is because I haven't done enough crafting, you know? Like, there's probably only like 4 or 5 people on our team that have custom weapons and a few that have custom armor and stuff, so I haven't done that much crafting, really. I probably should do another bout of it once I get some money. Like, is our main character got an upgraded sword? I don't think so. I don't know. Go on.
Well, I was just saying it's interesting that they all have names. Like, all the undead are people still.
Yep.
Albeit dead people.
Yep, definitely.
Like, yeah, Gildas. Gildas is dead. Confirmed. Rip that storyline.
You'll notice I brought Meriden, his buddy in arms. Remember there was that team of 5 from Lancelot in the first episode?
Yeah.
And I didn't bring Canopus, but I thought Meriden, there was like Lancelot, Gildas, Meriden, the Starseer, Oman, or whatever his name was, and Canopus. So I thought the 2 white knights might have like a camaraderie, you know, because they're the 2 soldiers. Meriden didn't even say anything. I was disappointed. I was hoping for
Gildas didn't even say anything.
Yeah, heartless bastard. See, I mean,
in his defense,
literally.
Yeah, I was going for the same jerk.
So anyway, we got to save these 2 people. Fortunately, they are having 2 people there makes all the difference. Like, as opposed to just trying to save
1 person,
correct,
who's all on their own.
And having a healer there makes the biggest difference. And one of them's a Terror Knight, which we haven't used too much of, which is a class that I don't usually use a lot, but I should be. I want to try and air all the classes because they're all cool, even if they're not all great. Sometimes you just... That's the good thing about this game. You can play through it once, and then you can play through it and take exactly the same choices and entirely change your game by how you play, right? Say I played this, and I went, you know what? I used 3 mages and 2 archers, and it was too easy. I'm going to not have a mage. I'm going to change my mages to, like, a special class. Like, we saw a witch, I think, or an enchantress, or we saw, like, a necromancer, or, you know... You're going to say, I'm not going to use a mage, I'm going to try these other classes. And I'm not going to use archers, I'm going to, you know, use a rune fencer, and I'm going to use something else. And so you make the game as easy or as difficult as you want. Like, you can just play around with different classes. And of course your main character can do anything, so you just pick what you want with him. We've been on rune fencer way too long, to be honest. I'm at the point where I'm almost thinking the one-handed sword is too restrictive for him. He can only be so many classes, so I should change to something that can operate with more classes. the other challenge here is keeping your clerics alive, because I have a feeling they know that the clerics are the big threats. And that might be right, the way they measure threat might be based upon, like, if you kill a unit, that raises your threat to, like, a lot, so they go after our clerics quickly, because they're the only ones who can land the killing blows.
Ooh.
And that's what happens when you bring a guy who's, like, four levels low.
Nah, he had enough HP for it.
Yeah, he ate it.
I don't know, Bully. This battle is starting to look like you don't have a ghost of a chance.
No. I know what that is.
Speaking!
Not like. Go on.
So I've been watching season one of Yu-Gi-Oh! Recently. That's where that line's from.
And if you don't know which episode, we can't tell you because it's like five episodes.
It's also a spoiler if you've never seen it before.
Yeah. If you haven't seen the original Yu-Gi-Oh!, get on that because it's heartwarming. And it's... Yeah, once you get over the silliness of playing card games to save the world, it's harmless and fun.
I don't know, I almost find the first season more dramatic in many ways. The difference between a good person, like a person good at the game and a person bad at the game is huge. Like, it really stands out. Like, and I know it's, when you get down to playing the actual game of Yu-Gi-Oh!, it's nothing like what the show represents it as, at least in the first season. But watching the difference between two characters is amazing. So, like, if you know the card game Yu-Gi-Oh!, we've talked about it before. There's a lot of mechanics in the game to sort of dictate how it flows and works. You've got to can only play monsters of 4 stars or lower, or you have to tribute summon, or, you know, all these little mechanics. Except the first season of Yu-Gi-Oh! The anime, they didn't know that, either because they were ignorant or because the rules hadn't been refined yet or something to do with that. And so the
well,
first season
I have a feeling
is
the card game
magical.
Didn't really exist. The TV show would have just been taking off the manga, which probably didn't define it that well, yeah. The rules
well,
probably
yeah, the manga,
didn't exist.
The manga was basically just the guy was he liked Magic the Gathering, so he made the concept in the manga, and then people were like, oh, this sounds like fun. What are the rules? So he set about doing the rules of the game. You know, he set out some basic rules for people to play.
Because what you got to understand is, and this is the story of the manga of Yu-Gi-Oh! It's not about the card game.
No. It's about the king of games.
The manga's all about the king of games, and he's sort of a gambler, but because he's infused with the power of darkness, he tends to win the gambles. But then again, sometimes it's not about him winning the gambles, it's he puts the other people and, like, basically dares them to take the risk, like, unnecessary risks, and then he wins that way. It's hard to explain. He basically finds bad people and says, yeah, you're being bad, and every time you're bad, you're taking a chance on dying or getting caught or hurting yourself, and that's how he basically captures or defeats them all. He puts them all in situations where their own compulsions that make them bad are the things that are getting them killed. I'm probably not describing that very faithfully, but that's kind of it.
Well, yeah, that's the basic concept. And over time, obviously they included popular fads at the time. There's one where it's got those little capsules you got from, like, gumball dispenser machines. And
right.
So there was a game about, you know, oh, we get these capsules and we use monsters from that. And then there was the Yu-Gi-Oh! Card game. And so over time, it sort of just developed as it did. And now it's the famous Yu-Gi-Oh! Anime and card game that you know of. But the point was, the first season, they didn't really have the rules, so it's a lot a lot of it's just made up. A lot of it is whatever we need to do to make it dramatic, but to be honest, that actually works because it does make it dramatic in the moment. You can't follow the rules, which is a real pity, but it's really neat to watch it all play out. Jesus.
They definitely sat down and said, what's the most interesting thing we can do to make this a show? And they said, well, basically Screw the rules, let's just let everyone get their best things and just, you know, do it, and then just have a way for the main character to beat it, and that's it. It's like, I remember, so one of the early episodes, and I think you'll go back to this at some point, but when Weevil summons his moth out of the cocoon,
yeah,
like, in the real card game, that strategy is just not something that's going to be easy to pull off, probably not practical, but it's they just said, well, look, we're just here to say it'll be more fun if he gets his best thing out and Yugi beats that. That's what the show's about. Taking on everyone's best and beating it. So it's no fun if he doesn't get it. And so yeah, they just spent the whole first season, they said, screw trying to set up situations that make it work, we'll just make it work. Who cares how?
Yeah.
We'll make up whatever rules we want that says he can't do whatever.
And that's what really made it so great. Like, the first season is absolutely magical. Especially when a lot of the cards that they play, a lot of the things they do, aren't they're not iconic at the point. Like, if you know the Yu-Gi-Oh! Anime, you know Dark Magician. That is Yu-Gi-Oh!'s go-to game-winning card. You know Karibo. That's his, you know, his good old friend, his reliable safety. You know, that's his thing.
Karibo is iconic because it kind of personifies Yugi as a character, I thought.
Yeah.
It's like weak and imposing, but it doesn't matter what your numbers are. It's all about what you can do with it. I don't know. I always felt that it was kind of an embodiment of what Yugi was as a character.
No, I agree. That's actually really good to the character, especially because he sees himself as the Dark Magician.
Right. And which is funny because, him and the Pharaoh. And that's what I always thought. And it doesn't really... That's probably a bit of, fan handling to get to that point. Maybe it doesn't ram that home, but that's what I always thought. That's
I
why
agree
those
that
characters
maybe,
are iconic.
Maybe we're sort of extrapolating and making up a little bit how, you know, these ideas, but you can see the groundwork for it. You can see the logic that some of these things might have been there. And that's what really made it so good. And that's why... Again, I'm just going to keep saying it, is the first season so great.
Well, honestly, let me just say, I don't actually feel bad about, like, even if we're making that up and that's not a thing at all, because I feel like when you watch a show like this, there's a certain amount of, like, what do you call it? Like, in your own mind, you've got to sort of immerse yourself, or you've got to sort of, you know, it's like any fantasy setting. It'll be sort of alright, but you yourself have got to be sort of ready and willing to accept and have a bit of fandom and, you know, put your own, like, headcanon into things. It's just a part of this sort of genre, I think.
I mean, we have to accept that getting 5 cards in your hand is considered unrealistically impossible in the context of the game for the first episode to even make sense to us. But that's fine. Like, but it works. All of it still just works. But yeah, the point I was saying earlier, the difference between the strength of duelists really shows up. Like, one of the things they set up is these two characters, Rex and Weevil, and they're regional champions. And Weevil's known as a strategist, and he beats Rex. And so when it comes to the time for the main characters to play against them, Yugi ends up playing against Weevil, who is the strategist, and Yugi is the best player of his friend circle. Joey, on the other hand, is an absolutely terrible player by comparison. His main strategy is play monster, and that's it.
His main strategy is luck.
Well, at that point in the game, at that point in the story, he didn't even have that going for him, I guess. No, because I'm talking about the first time he uses the Time Wizard.
Ah.
Oh no, sorry, it is the second time. My bad. But the point being, he really wasn't an experienced player. He would just throw out what was in his hand on the field. And the point is that Rex went up against him. So it was, they put a sort of a brute force character against a more brute force character, and the clever character against the clever character, and you could sort of see the different levels of competence throughout the game, like throughout the story and throughout how it's told. And it was really, it's really interesting to me to watch that sort of Joey isn't as good, but he's learning very quickly, whereas Yugi is like a master of the game and he can throw down with the greatest of them.
Yeah.
Like that is brilliant and like very simple but very effectively told.
Yeah, I think the first season was a lot more honest. Like, they were much more interested in creating just whatever the best plot sequences were. And then it was sort of like as they went on to future seasons and they you know, had to... Well, they didn't have to, but they started following rules a little bit more. I won't say entirely, but they followed rules a bit more and things like that. Then it became a lot more about, you know, they have to say, oh, well, this rule says you can't summon this unless you do that, so I have to find a way to make that happen. And, you know, they had to, like, reverse engineer the whole plot to get to that point, whereas at the start, they were just like... I want Kaiba to summon three blue eyes because that's fun, and we don't need to create a reason or an excuse, he just will, you know?
Like how you're soloing a dragon right now.
Yeah. Soloed a dragon.
The other one I'd like to point out is the ongoing rivalry between Yugi and Kaiba is... I wouldn't say it's ever as good as it is in the first season. In the first season, Yugi plays Kaiba in their first match, and he wins because he has Exodia, which is an instant game win card combo. You need five cards, once you've got them, you win. That's how the combo works.
That's so iconic. And, that whole series could... Yeah. Like, if that didn't happen, people wouldn't... It's such a thing. Everyone... Like, it's internet meme status now, of course, but it just... It's such an iconic moment. If you're a fan or you've ever enjoyed the series, it's something you'll always remember.
Yeah. And... So that's their first duel. And then the next thing that happens over the course of the game is someone steals his Exodia cards, Yugi's Exodia cards, and throws them in the ocean. So he loses them, basically forever. That's it. They're gone. And then he fights, and this is where the line came from. Sorry for spoilers for the first season of the first series of Yu-Gi-Oh. He fights the ghost of Kaiba, supposedly, using Seto Kaiba's deck. Except now he doesn't have Exodia, so he needs some way to beat Kaiba and his legendary Blue Eyes, which are the most powerful monsters in the game. And he doesn't actually beat them, not legitimately. What happens is, over the course of the game, the real Seto Kaiba, who is not actually dead, hacks into basically the dueling system and lowers the attack points of the fake ghost Seto Kaiba and makes his Blue Eyes weak enough that Yugi can overcome them. And what this has established is, twice now, Yugi hasn't actually been able to beat the Blue Eyes without using some sort of, like, trick, without using some sort of alternate method. It's reinforcing the fact that Kaiba is still, despite losing, a basically unstoppable duelist. And then what happens is he finally comes up where a point where Seto and Yugi do have to duel again. And this time, it's no hold barred. Nobody interrupts. It's just them playing against each other, doing whatever strategy they can. And Seto gets out his Blue Eyes, all three of them, combines them all into one Super Blue Eyes.
Which we hadn't seen by that point.
Yeah, and Yugi overcomes it with using Karibo, like you said.
Yeah.
What we could theoretically say represents Yugi himself. And he uses it and another card, and it makes this giant infinite barrier. And then, to top that off, Yugi uses a combination of things to weaken the Blue Eyes Ultimate Dragon to a point where he could beat Seto. And it's at that point where Yugi as a character has gone from using basically gimmicks and strategies and I guess cheating to an extent for the second match, but to the point where he's actually overcome
Dropping
Kaiba
someone's
as a
flying
duelist.
Castle on their monsters is a real strategy, surely.
It was in the first season, but lowering someone's points through hacking isn't,
summoning
I don't think.
The moon to affect the tides of the water and something? I don't remember how that went down.
I'll explain later. Maybe.
It's alright.
But the point being is, at that point in the story, Yugi finally has proven that he is now the best duelist in the world, in the terms of this world. With the exception of, we don't know how he fares against the villain of the story. Just how he fares against the current number one. And that's, like, as a character, that's amazing. Like, the outcome of that is really endearing, and it shows an evolution of the story.
Do you think
and
that also, on another note, adds extra layers to the bad guy? The big bad guy that I think you decided not to mention his name on purpose, so I won't.
Oh, I didn't. It was Pegasus, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm having a mental blank.
That's all right. Do you feel like... See, he hears that Yugi beats Kaiba and then says, this guy is the thing. Like, he pretty much cottons on straight away what's going on here. He has the artifact. He must be the Pharaoh. I know all about these things because I did my research.
Yeah.
And then, like, it kind of adds to his character too, because he knew from that minute that Yugi was his threat, his biggest threat, and he needed to coerce him into this thing. And, you know, it's only when he starts beating Kaiba that the rest of the audience really can appreciate that.
Yeah, and
well,
the other important thing to note there in the story, at that point in the story, is when Yugi versus Kaiba for the third time and beats him fairly with no sort of outside influence or lucky trick, Kaiba doesn't actually lose that match because he threatens to throw himself off the castle and kill himself. And Yugi refuses to kill him, like, because he theoretically could fall in that situation somehow.
But I probably could.
The point being,
I believe that.
Yeah. No, the point being, so he threatens to kill himself, and but the Pharaoh, the ancient Egyptian Pharaoh that lives inside Yugi, attempts to attack him, because to him, winning the duel and thus having a chance at saving Yugi's grandpa was more important than sparing Seto's life. And that sort of also set up at that point a very deep sort of character, in that the Pharaoh is more dark, whereas Yugi is more like Kuribo. He spares a life. In this case, he sacrificed his chance at saving his grandpa and himself to let Seto Kaiba win, to save Seto's life.
Yeah, and the Pharaoh, it also builds the background story of the Pharaoh being a Pharaoh, because in his time, you know, I don't think you would think twice about killing someone in that situation.
No, no, he wouldn't.
They issued a challenge, the stakes are high, I have to kill him to get through it, fine, I'll kill him. I feel like in the Pharaoh's time, that would be kind of, I don't know, normal.
Yeah, a given. I mean, it was Egypt.
Yeah, I know, so seeing that seeing that happen is, like, it reinforces that point to the audience. It's good.
Yeah. No, I think that's definitely something that's there. Like, there's just that level of depth in the story over time. And it might not all be intended, but it's all there. And the way the characters interact around Yugi is also fairly compelling. I don't know, like, Teya, she's just sort of Yugi's cheerleader throughout the entire story. But seeing her sort of step up and try and defeat Mai, because after the Seto battle, Yugi sort of loses it, because he's worried that the Pharaoh might hurt someone if they duel again. And Teya goes, no, look, I'll prove to you that I'll fight someone even though I'm worried. You know, worried that I might lose or something.
It's, but, yeah, she's like, it's not about winning or losing, it's about standing up for...
Yeah, and the point is that the character steps up to, you know, actually do something and get involved, and it's sort of respectable. I don't know, it's just watching the way the characters interact is somewhat very interesting to me. Because I just found...
The other big thing they change between the Duel Monsters show and the manga is the other main character... excuse me. The other character in the group with Yugi. I don't know if you know about that. Surely you heard about that.
No, I do.
So, they took another female character out. I don't know why, but I think at the end of the day, it kind of works out for them, because it creates a better relationship between, like, Joey and Tristan.
Yeah.
And I think that those two are, like, really interesting characters, especially considering one of them's a duelist and one isn't, you know? Like,
yeah.
It just makes you feel like... I don't know. I just always liked the way those two interact, and their story is so different to what the manga is that it's important that they had stuff to do and deal with and people to talk to and people to interact with. And I feel like if they had an extra character, it would have just been, you know, just a flood of characters to fill up the screen.
Yeah, and the characters, in all fairness, already there's so many of them that you don't really get a gist for all of them. Like, it does take you sort of some time to really adjust to how many there are.
The trouble is that by the time you instigate, like, a big bad... Oh, shit, there's a lot of things there. and then, like, a few sort of deputies for him, and then sort of villain of the week things, and then you've got Yugi, you've got Kaiba, who sort of is like a side rival that doesn't go away, and then Yugi's friends, and Mai, who's another sort of side rival that doesn't go away, and yeah, it the roster starts chalking up hugely. So it's important that you sort of streamline Yugi's team, like Joey and Taya and all that, because you need to keep them all relevant and all doing stuff. Whereas if you had more of them, there'd just be too much going on, I think. But like you say, because the show's so steeped in its character moments, it's kind of significant to mention that, I thought.
You know the part that I forgot, which is probably one of the most important things, is in the duel shortly after, and this will obviously, you'll need to know this one because I'm not going to explain every single character, but after the Kaiba duel, Taya fights Jules Mai, and Mai's technically could win the duel, but chooses not to. And the reason this is important is because of how it reflects what just happened to Yugi. And it's sort of that helps him realize what happened. That, I don't know, sometimes there's something more important than dueling, and it's okay to lose.
Well, I think the point is that it's not worth... I think the point of the show, and it's a bit... It's not as... Again, this might be a bit of fan handling, but they're trying to say that how you duel reflects you as a person.
Yeah.
And if you are going to do the things, like in Yugi's case, beating Kaiba and potentially harming him as a person, well, that's not what Yugi is. And same with Mai, in the sense of being Taya and potentially like kicking everyone while they're down kind of thing. That's what Mai's not about. She's challenging and she's competitive, but she's not like rotten.
Yeah.
And that's the difference. And when I think that actually is a good explanation, because it explains why they made Joey's deck based around a lot of like luck and stuff. It's not supposed to be luck so much as he's like a high octane, high risk, high reward kind of guy, and that's his personality, and that is reflected in his deck. So I think, like you say, when you're talking about the early setup, it's hard. I'd have to watch some of the later seasons to see if they sort of follow this all through. But I feel like, yeah, they're setting up a lot of this stuff quite well.
Yeah, I feel like the show doesn't really compare after this point. I feel like after they got away from the first season, they're like, oh, this is a real card game now. We've got to do it properly. You know, we've got to play by the rules and all that. I feel like it started to get a bit too, not constricting, but they sort of forgot the fun of the card game, of the story, in favor of being like, here are some new cards that we've just released. Have a look at what they do, you know. Sort of, I don't want to say they were advertising in the anime, but they sort of were. Any new strategy or cards that would come out, they'd be like, oh, this is a person that's using that.
And well, they'd use the show to like springboard potential cards and whatever stuck.
Yeah.
And turn into the card game.
I mean, you only need to see Yu-Gi-Oh! GX to really see that in effect with Elemental Heroes.
But sometimes I like GX just for the sake of, yeah, they're following the rule, but.
Oh,
and
yeah.
They're a bit more, like, in your face about it, but they're definitely, all the things that I've just said about people's decks reflecting who they are and the interactions between people can be reflected in the interactions between their decks and stuff like that. I don't know. I feel like...
I think the real problem...
Even though it cops a lot of flack.
Yeah. No, well, I don't know if I'd call this a problem, but I think... Oh, is this a cinematic?
Dun, 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 dun. Yeah. We might wind down with the cinematic. It goes for a few minutes, but it's interesting.
Sure. Well, I was just going to say, I think the thing about the Yu-Gi-Oh! Is it sort of got away from sort of shackled together decks.
Oh, what's wrong with your face?
Of just whatever cards you had. And instead it started to be like, oh, you have to run this strategy. And then that even bled into the show, which sort of took away from the drama and fun.
Yeah, I think so. I think if from a characters and that sort of thing, I thought it was a little bit more probably interesting overall, but yeah, the card game itself got a bit hammy.
I would definitely rewatch the first season if you haven't for a while. It's to the side while you're doing something else, but it's definitely a treat. It really is. You just got to sort of take it all in and appreciate it.
Yeah, I like it.
In all its glorious ham and terribleness. Some of it's so silly and cringeworthy, like you know, baby's first anime dubbed by 4 kids, but it's so delightful also in that same vein. Love watching old animes.
If you find good ones, yeah.
In the 90s, whenever you couldn't say die or you weren't allowed to kill anyone.
Oh dear. It's the Yu-Gi-Oh! Movie coming out. Real life movie. What do you call it? Live action.
Really? Please no.
I'm waiting for the Looney Tunes-esque Pokemon movie. With live action acting and then CGI Pokemon.
Pokemon Go, the movie?
Yep, that's what I'm... It'll be led by that guy who's in the Looney Tunes from How Much Mother or whatever. The big guy with the blonde hair.
Oh.
I don't know his name. I don't watch that show.
Well, it's a good thing you know who you're talking about.
I just know what he looks like. I don't know his name.
We're talking about Neil Patrick Harris. So...
Nabeth Oberlord. No, I know who Neil Patrick Harris is. He doesn't have blonde hair.
Okay, thank God.
What are you talking about?
What?
Isn't he dark haired? No.
I thought he was light haired.
Maybe he's
Everything light-haired. I've seen of him, he seemed light haired.
Maybe he is naturally light haired. I think I must have one image in my head when he was dark haired. Maybe like Starship Troopers or something. He was. But maybe that was a wig. Because that was kind of hammy.
Man, I hope she's a necromancer.
Sybil.
She's not, is it? She's a healer.
She's a Sybil. That's her brother. He speaks. I don't think he's living. Do you even live?
Did you even live, bro?
I had to say that line. You have to get the incredulous. He's incredulous. This is like body horror kind of shit. He's like, I have my mind, but this isn't my body.
I think that's something like a Dunedain or something. Some sort of a Welsh thing. Basically a headless knight that has its head.
I don't think he even means that. I think he purely means that even his face isn't who he is.
Oh, maybe.
I think he explains it. See, he uses a soul-fetching spell to call him back from the shores of death. So this guy's body, he was beheaded and destroyed. He
Ouch.
Was dead for 5 days.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure you can't resuscitate people after that time.
No, he's a necromancer. He reconstituted him. Oh, yeah, he fixed his head to another corpse, you're right. Well, that's disgusting.
Ah, come on, that's not so bad. He just would have had to have found a corpse of a similar size.
I wonder if his name is a kind of a pun. I can't help
Divold.
It. A, he died. But I also wonder if it's like devoid.
Maybe.
Devoid of life or whatever. Maybe not, and it's actually just a pure translation of the, say, the Japanese name, but
Well, no shit, the soul fetching was incomplete. He's not alive!
Well, I think, no, well, what they're gonna explain in a minute is he's actually dying.
Yeah.
So he's saying if it was a success, he wouldn't be alive, but he wouldn't instantly keel over in time.
So, here's a question that I get to throw at you for another time. Is, do you get these characters if you play the pure good path?
I don't believe so.
Awesome. I am totally on board with this path now.
I've played the good path. This is the first time I've ever seen this cutscene, so I think the answer
is no. But didn't you play this before we record it?
Yeah. I've never played the chaotic route before. Yeah, I've played good and I've played evil and then there's one in the middle.
Well,
let me explain that, right? I got 5 minutes, right?
Yep.
So there's three routes, as I can understand it. And look at that, I can have them join us. Do we want the dead guy on the team?
Hell yes.
You know we do. I got a couple of minutes, let me quickly rush through this. So there's three paths. There's lawful, neutral, chaotic. We're on the neutral path because this is how it went. We made... At Balmamusa, that's where it kind of splits in half, right? We made the chaotic decision not to follow Leonar and massacre people. Because he was ordered by his king to do that. And so if we'd have said yes, that's lawful. Which is crazy.
But it's also good.
Yeah, it's also good. But what you got to understand is the roots aren't good or evil. The roots are lawful and chaotic. So we went down the chaotic route, where everything fell to shit because we didn't do it, and we basically turned ourselves into like another gang in the world, and we weakened the Duke by not joining him. And then we ended up neutral because we went back to him later. So,
well, yeah, okay, I see what you mean.
Interesting. That's the three plots, right?
Yeah, I can sort of see what you're talking. Like, I can see the whole neutral thing when you say it like that, because it was lawful to go back to the Duke to be like, okay, we're going to embrace order and law to do things that will save the nation. We're just not bad. We refuse to do evil things.
Well, the point I guess I'm trying to make is that the game at no point impresses on you whether you need, like, whether you're good or evil. It just tells you whether you're doing the lawful thing or you're doing the chaotic thing, which is sort of following your own thing. And I don't know if those, actually, I don't know if those things are like built in the game, but you know how, like, you can see on the screen, Divold has a C next to him? That's a chaotic thing, so you can have all characters have an alignment. So I suspect you could probably have characters that fall out with you if you go full chaotic and you have all lawful characters.
I just wanted to say as well, the idea of lawful good is often a misnomer. The idea that, you know, lawful good is following the law always, or is doing good always, is sort of deceptive. A lawful good is only doing what the law tells you when it is both lawful and good. So, like, the idea of following the chaotic path isn't really following the chaotic path. Like,
you know what we need to do is have... I need to go research that, and we should talk about that for like a whole episode.
No, let's do it next time.
Go through
time,
all
write
the
down.
Nine categories or something and just cut through them.
Yeah, from D&D.
That'd be fantastic. Well, there's like a standardized one, but D&D style. That'd be fantastic. That's a really cool thing to talk about. I hope I hope anyone who's listening to this agrees. Because I love to talk about that stuff. Because I'd love to do that and then project about what the characters are. Like, what's our character? And then what would I be as a person? What would you be as a person? That's fun. It reminds me of Baldur's Gate, where I first got introduced to that concept. Another reason why I love that game.
Anyway, thank you so much for joining us. I just want to cut us off because we're running out of seconds.
Yeah, that's alright. This is our holding wrap-up, get out of here screen. Thank you to everyone, as Patch said. And we will catch you guys next time.
See yous then.
Bye.